Good morning to all of you. I'm going to take up two major themes this morning. The leftover of yesterday, indirect instruction or indirect teaching. As I told you yesterday, direct teaching methods, they aim at ensuring lower level learning. What are the lower level learnings? Can you tell me? One of you stand up and say, what are lower level learning? Any one of you? That is in Bloom's taxonomic classification. I told you specifically what are the learning outcomes associated with knowledge, comprehension and application. This knowledge, comprehension and application, they are obviously associated with lower level learning outcomes. I use three keywords to describe the lower learning outcomes. Who will help me to come to the answer? Very good. Learning of facts, learning of rules, and learning of action sequences. When you connect facts and explain something, try to understand something in a better way by connecting facts, that becomes a rule. And in mathematics, social sciences, physical sciences, languages, you'll have good many examples of facts. Relationship among facts called rules, and the action sequences which exhibit or reflect, again, a bit higher than the rules. The strategies that I discussed yesterday, they were all direct teaching strategies or direct methods. Lecturing, expository, I gave you five methods. Do you remember those five methods? Any one of you who will come forward? What were the five teaching methods which we called as direct teaching methods? Any one of you? Yes, you come to their rescue. Stand up. Yes. Interaction, interactive lectures. Then, team teaching, very good. Demonstration, very good. Lectures with examples. Yes, these were the five. I'm very happy that in one day's time, you have not forgotten. Many people forget after the presentation itself. So now I will go to the indirect methods. You should note one thing, all these direct methods of teaching were developed under one psychological theory that is called the theory of behaviorism, behavioristic theories. Lot of work was done in the early 20th century and the middle of, up to the middle of 20th century on developing behavioristic theories of learning. Thorndike system, Pavlov's conditioning, Skinner's conditioning, these were the various procedures experimentally undertaken to demonstrate how learning can take place at lower level. Then a concern came for higher level learning. Higher level learning analysis, synthesis, and evaluation. And I again use three keywords to describe those higher level learnings. What were those three keywords? Concept and inquiry and problem solving. These were the three types of learning. In terms of Gaine's hierarchy, I refer to Gaine's hierarchy, Robert M. 8 types of learning. So the indirect teaching methods, they are intended to produce high level learning. As you find in your situations, we have made it to appear as if there is no case for higher level, only memorizing, understanding, that's all. Is it not? In your classrooms, you teach to develop, promote memorization, at the most understanding. But you don't go to a higher level, analysis, synthesis, and critical thinking, development and promotion of critical thinking among your students. So, unfortunately, in the Asian region, and particularly in our own space, you will find educational systems, they are showing now a concern for promoting higher level learning. Learning to form concepts, then using concepts to explain something in an inquiry mode and help solve problems. Again, you remember three words: process, content, and context. These three keywords, please remember. Inquiry approach in producing high-level learning is the process. So what is the process put to use in higher-level learning? Inquiry. Inquiry mode. Inquiry approach. Asking what is what, why it is so, how it is so. When you develop your lessons in an inquiry mode, you ask several questions like why it is so, how it appears so. If I put these things this and this way, what will happen? This is an inquiry mode. So process in producing higher level learning is marked by, characterized by inquiry process. So the whole process becomes inquiry process. And what is the content? The content is the concept. What is the content? Content is the concept. Yesterday I told you what is a concept. Ultimate purpose of teaching at any level, primary, secondary, higher education, is to develop concepts. There are three types of concepts. One we call conjunctive concepts. Conjunctive concepts. So you put characteristic 1, characteristic 2, characteristic 3, characteristic 4. Put all the characteristics together and you form a concept. This, 4 legs, power of smell, that makes a dog. So you enumerate various characteristics to arrive at the concept of a dog or concept of a cat, or for that matter, any object, any event. There are concepts which are conjunctive concepts. So conjunctive concepts are those where you add up the characteristics, the essential characteristics. For instance, in developing your concept of animal and man, what is the difference between man and animal? Man is one concept and animal is another concept. You will lay down several characteristics of animality. Animal eats, animal drinks, animal seeks shelter, animal sleeps. These are all characteristics. Animal, so it satisfies all the physiological needs. You enumerate all those physiological needs, characteristics. When the animal does all those activities, but those activities, those characteristics are there in man also. Man also eats, drinks, seeks shelter, and wants to find out something which will help him or her to survive. So survival needs. Animal also wants survival. Man also wants survival. So what is the difference between man and animal? Is there any difference? What is the difference? Yes, please. These two concepts are different concepts. And when teaching about animality and the concept of man, you will highlight the common factors. But you will see, what is it that differentiates animal from man? Rationality. Man is a rational animal. So animality plus rationality makes a man. If you are not rational, rational means thoughtful. Man thinks, animal does not think. So that is the essential attribute of being man. These two concepts, these are called conjunctive concepts. That means you add up a few characteristics. You observe those characteristics, add up those characteristics, and you will find those characteristics which differentiate, those characteristics which are shared by all animals, shared by all human beings. All human beings, they think. So the difference is there. I told you yesterday that the concept is a class of objects, events, which generalizes within and differentiates between the classes. So between man and animal, what is the difference? Rationality. So when you teach, likewise, several concepts, concept of water, concept of cold, concept of heat, these are all in natural sciences, you have so many, full of. So what you teach is actually concepts. And unless you have developed the concepts yourself, you cannot teach the concepts to your students. So concepts have to be formed, then only you can help your students to attain concept. That there is a model called concept attainment model. You help them. How do you help? So, for conjunctive concepts, the method will be slightly different from disjunctive concepts. What is disjunctive concept? You put two, three things obliquely, in an oblique way, and then you say, he is like this. For instance, you take a concept like love, and you take a concept like rose. Rose is a concept. Love is, which one is concrete, rose or love? Rose. But you say, love is like rose. This is disjunctive concept. Rose, you know? It smells, gives a good smell, good looking. You are attracted towards it, isn't it? Rose, you are attracted. When you find that rose is there on the plant, is smiling, you also smile. There is fragrance, there is attraction, and you are drawn towards rose, isn't it? And what is love? In love also, you are drawn towards somebody. There is an attraction. So, when you are comparing love is rose, or love-rose combination, that is a disjunctive concept. Two different things, but you are putting them. So many things in our curriculum, you have to identify what are conjunctive. Conjunctive concepts are easy to teach. Disjunctive concepts will be difficult to teach. And the third is still more difficult to teach, relational concepts. Relational. So these are the three types of concepts: conjunctive concepts, disjunctive concepts, and relational concepts. Distance, for example, concept of distance, concept of duration, concept of time, concept of age. How do we calculate your age? How do you calculate your age? From the point of time you were reported to be born up to now, your age is calculated. It's a relation in terms of time. So from yesterday up to this point, your age has grown. When we met yesterday, you were 25 hours junior, younger. Now you are 24 hours senior. And concept of understanding, concept, all these are relational concepts. So you understand. He understands up to a particular, and he understands. So there will be certain persons who will fully understand. There will be certain persons who will partially understand. And there will be certain persons who will not understand. They will misunderstand. Here in this audience also, you have these three types of people. Those who understand fully what I say. Those who understand partially what I am saying, and those who, I don't want to use this word, those who misunderstand. Whatever I say, they do not understand, they misunderstand. So misunderstanding is a concept, understanding is another concept. All these are abstract concepts. And relational concepts. All relational concepts are very difficult to teach. You can teach about a dog. You can teach about a donkey. Very easy to teach. Donkey has its own characteristics. But you say, when you say, this fellow looks like a donkey, this becomes a different concept altogether. This fellow looks like a monkey. There is a difference between monkey and donkey. If you go to a temple and you have something in your hand, and there are two animals there, one is monkey and the other is donkey, you should be careful of donkey or monkey? Monkey. He's a very clever person. You have your lunch packet or something to eat, and he will look where is it located. And he will take, go to Sankat Mochan, and will find monkeys are very clever. So Sankat Mochan monkey and the ordinary monkey. One of my friends, we collaborated, he was a psychologist. We studied the behavior of urban monkey and forest monkey. There is a difference between the behavior of urban monkey and the forest monkey. We made this study long back, after Harlow had reported some of the studies on monkeys about learning to learn. This concept was advanced by Harlow, that every intelligent person learns how to learn. So learning to learn. In monkeys, he made the experiment. And when we were doing this, forest monkeys, we went to the forest. My friend had a jeep and we went to the forest. We found the moment we entered that space where those monkeys were there, they will look at us and they will run away. They will be afraid of us. But urban monkey, you have to be afraid of them. That is the critical difference between the behavior of urban monkey and the forest monkey. Forest monkey will be afraid of you, but urban monkey, you have to be afraid of them. Luckily, there is no monkey on this campus. Are there monkeys?
Yes, sir.
So you have to be very, very careful. Now, the attributes of monkeys and donkeys you can generalize to human beings also. This fellow looks like a donkey. And unfortunately, there are some words also. Crow and owl. O-W-L. Who is more intelligent? Crow or owl? In Hindi, Hindi language, how many of you understand Hindi? Everybody? See? If the parents become angry with the children, they use this adjective, you are an owl. Tum ullu ho ullu. Is it not? In anger, they use this word owl. And owl means having more intelligence or less intelligence. And crow, kawa, kawa hai kawa. Aur kaha bhi jata hai, pakshiyon mein kawa aur aadmiyon mein nauwa. Nauwa means barbar. Ye sab banaya hua hai. Aadmi mein nauwa, nauwa means barbar. He will go on doing your malish and all that. Kya kar rahe hain, kya malish karega, khub badhiya se karega. Aur jeb par nazar hogi. और आपकी इतनी मालिश करेगा कहेगा कि कितने दिन का प्रोग्राम है आपका बाबू साहब आप कहेंगे कितने दिन का है पांच दिन का है कितना दिन हो गया है चार दिन हो गया बाबू आप सबसे अव्वल आएंगे प्रोग्राम में और वो मालिश ऐसे ऐसे करता रहेगा और आप खुश होकर कहेंगे कि अच्छा इसने कहा अव्वल आएंगे फर्स्ट आएंगे लो 10 रुपया आदमियों में न हुआ है और पक्षियों में ना दैट इज हाउ यू रिलेट एट्रीब्यूट्स कैरेक्टरिस्टिक्स कीप इट एट दैट सो यू अंडरस्टैंड कॉन्सेप्ट्स आर वेरी डिफिकल्ट टू टीच व्हिच कॉन्सेप्ट इज मोस्ट डिफिकल्ट टू टीच रिलेशनल कॉन्सेप्ट डिसजंक्टिव कॉन्सेप्ट एंड लेस डिफिकल्ट टू टीच conjunctive concept. You go on helping your students to collect the characteristics, then generalize, and then differentiate from this set of characteristics with another set of characteristics not found there. So, how many of you are language teachers? Language teachers? Very good. So, if you are teaching about noun, from your text, you will take paragraphs and say, you will underline 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2. 1 means noun words and 2 means other than noun words. The man killed the lion. The man killed the lion. So you will underline man and lion. 1. And killed the 2, 1, 2. Now let us take another sentence. The lion killed the man. The sentence is different. In the other, what is the subject? The man killed the lion. Here, the lion killed the man. You can see the difference. But the nomenclature, man and lion, is the same. So both are noun words. Put this pencil on the table and you will have 10 sentences. 1, 2, 1, 2, you will write. And you will say, look at these 1, 2, 1, 2. So all those which are underlined as 1, they are noun words. What is the common thing? They are the name of something. So you have now introduced the concept. Now you will give another paragraph, new sentences, and you will ask your students to do the same job which you have done in the material earlier. That is how you do concept teaching. Concept learning will be taking place if you present the material first. Then you ask the students to identify those characteristics which go with the noun words and which do not go with the noun words. So he will discriminate between and generalize within the class. That is concept making. So you go on producing as many examples as you can. And concept learning cannot take place unless you give large number of examples. We call it positive examples, negative examples. Noun words, positive examples. Those which are not noun words, these are negative examples. So the student will understand what is the common thing. Noun may be the name of a person. It may be the name of place. It may be the name of an object or name of anything. So he understands noun means name of anything. Person, place are things, events. These are noun words. And that way you develop their concept of noun. What is pronoun? Pronoun is that which comes in place of noun. Suresh went to the market to have some apples. He went to the nearest market to locate the fruits which were available. Now you can see, you can now distinguish which word comes in place of Suresh, which word comes in place of the fruit or the name of the. So when he went to the fruit market, he found that apples were not there, and whatever were there, these were not eatable. Now these were not eatable. You can see, you can develop large number of these presentations. You get at what I'm saying? So in concept learning, there are 5 steps. Please write down. Selection of material. whether it is science, whether it is mathematics, whether it is social science, whether it is language. Select the material which will be the exemplification of the concept, which will be the illustration of the concept. Selection of material. So you have to do a lot of job as a teacher. The first job, the first step implies that you will select good many materials in your file, various types of materials. Materials which are centered on the concept, which are related to the concept. Not any material, but the material which will be related to the concept that you are going to teach. For instance, if you are going to teach about noun, then you will have 5, 6, 7, 8, 10, 20, 50 paragraphs. From out of those paragraphs, you will make use of. Now the second step will be labeling. First is, and second is labeling the concept with positive examples and negative examples. So positive examples will be one, negative examples will be two. So this is the second step, labeling. This is very important. Then third step, discussion. Discussion, description based on the essential and non-essential characteristics of the concept. What is essential and what is not essential? Third step. This is the third step. Very important. You have to discuss. You have to describe to your students what is essential and what is not essential. Okay. Then fourth step. You will give the material to the students and you now will not do yourself. You will ask your students to put 1, 2, 1, 2 in the number of sentences in a paragraph. One will describe noun words, two will describe non-noun words. And see how many students are able to do it. That means they are now trying to understand the concept. And you will discuss, if someone has made an error, you will discuss why it is an error. Why it is not a noun, you will discuss. You will describe what are the critical features of a noun. So all this. How many steps you have? The last step is, fourth step is formulating the helping students to formulate the generalizations and distinctive features. The generalizations and the distinctive features in the items presented. If it is some other concept, events are there, episodes are there, then what are the critical features which can be generalized? And what are those critical features which stand apart and make a difference? And lastly, you have to ask the students from your textbook, lesson one, identify the concepts, identify noun words, make a list of noun words. And if you have developed noun words, how many noun words are there? Anyone? Name of a person? So you have common noun, you have All these nouns you have forgotten. So now you will help, ask your students to classify those noun words, which are names of persons, which are names of places, and common nouns, and then abstract nouns, and so all these, and that way you will develop concept in your history. You get it, get the point? That will hold good in mathematics also. That will hold good in science. Many things help them, you present. And please note that the first three steps are teacher guided, and the last two steps are student guided. Student himself guides what is to be done. So that way, concept learning will take place correctly and quickly. Now, second, I have explained to you concept learning. And I explained to you, for each type of concept, you know, the procedure will be the same. Whether it is conjunctive concept or disjunctive concept or relational concept, the procedure will be the same. It's a matter of details. You can hold one full workshop on this, promoting concept learning. And you can take your syllabus, curriculum, and render it in terms of concept mapping. We call it concept mapping. And you can develop a concept map yourself, or you can help your students to do the concept mapping, the higher concept, subordinate concept, concept which go within those subordinate ones, like this. That is called concept mapping. It has emerged as a new strategy for helping teachers to promote concept learning. Concept learning can be effectively ensured through helping students to formulate a concept map. So, hydrogen, oxygen, and under hydrogen and under oxygen, hydrogen, you will have sub-concepts, then a sub-concept like that. Just as I said, noun, you have the generic word noun, then you have personal noun, then you have common noun, and in each you will go on specifying. So that is how we go. Inquiry training, now the second, as I told you, in indirect methods, inquiry is the process, and concept is the content. So in concept learning, the whole process will be inquiry process. Why it is a noun word? Why it is not a noun word? You will go on examining in the first three steps, helping students to inquire in these last two steps. So inquiry process will be linked with the concept learning. So I will not discuss at length, because my lecture for today is on management of learning. So I'm just completing what was left yesterday. The third is problem solving. So inquiry, you have five steps again in inquiry process. Please write down what are the five. In inquiry process, the first starting point is the puzzling situation. You have to confront your students with a puzzling situation. For instance, in a sentence you say, these are not nouns. Why they are not nouns? What is their function in a sentence? So let the student be confronted with a puzzling situation. What is a noun situation? This is a noun, this is not a noun, this is a noun, this is not a noun. So this is the first thing, puzzling situation. Inquiry process begins with a puzzling situation. Suppose you have forgotten something and you are in need of that something. What do you do? क्या करते हैं आप? आपको पेन चाहिए, आप खास पेन यूज करते हैं और आप भूल गए हैं घर में. ये इंक्वायरी प्रोसेस हो ना, कहाँ है? आप कहते हैं बेडरूम में तो नहीं है, ड्राइंग रूम में तो नहीं है. करते हैं या नहीं? और उसमें झगड़ा लड़ाई भी हो जाती है, बताते क्यों नहीं कहाँ है. पजलिंग सिचुएशन हुआ ना, और आपको लिखना है और कोई आपको हाथ में पकड़ा रहा है कि ये ले लो तब तक काम करोगे. नहीं, मुझे वही चाहिए, तो उसमें फ्लो अच्छा होता है. अब देखो पजलिंग सिचुएशन. अब आप कहते हैं अच्छा पेन हमने अपने रीडिंग टेबल पर रखा. तो आप क्या करेंगे? सेकेंड स्टेप, पिन पॉइंटिंग और लोकेटिंग ए स्पेसिफिक स्पेस. सो पजलिंग सिचुएशन इन द इंक्वायरी प्रोसेस यू विल स्पेसिफाई ए पर्टिकुलर स्पेस वेयर मूविंग टू व्हिच यू विल बी एबल टू प्रोसीड फर्दर इन योर इंक्वायरी. सो विल गो एंड आप देखेंगे कि टेबल पर तो नहीं है, आप देखेंगे डेस्क में उसमें तो नहीं है, ड्रायर में तो नहीं है. देखेंगे फिर देख रहे हैं अच्छा यहाँ भी नहीं है. इंक्वायरी भी प्रोसेस कंटिन्यूज. अच्छा मैं सोते समय मैंने पेन यूज किया था, किताब में रख दिया होगा. तो जो किताब आप पढ़ रहे थे उस किताब को खुद, अरे ये किताब होता है या नहीं. सो थर्ड स्टेप इज फाइंडिंग आउट समथिंग इन इंक्वायरी. When you make inquiries, there are always findings. There may be real findings, there may be substitute findings. तो जैसे यहां पर तो real finding हो गया कि अच्छा मिल गई. अब आप देखते हैं कि ये वही pen है जो मैं use करता हूं, या ऐसा तो नहीं है कि और किताब में रख दिया उसी तरह की pen. आपके पास दो तीन pen हैं, तो आप देखिए कौन सा पेन आपको इस समय चाहिए. मान लीजिए आपको बैंक के चेक पर दस्तखत करना है, तो बैंक के चेक बुक पर दस्तखत करने के लिए खास पेन चाहिए. नीला वाला पेन होगा तो वो करेंगे, तो आपका चेक एक्सेप्ट नहीं होगा. अब आप देखिए ये प्रोसेस गोज ऑन, इट्स वाइडर सर्च कंटिन्यूज. सो फ्रॉम द स्पेसिफिक सर्च टू द थर्ड स्टेप wider search, and fourth is finding out a hypothetical solution. Fourth stage is hypothetical solution, and then finally an acceptable solution which can be accepted. So these are the five stages of inquiry. So now I have explained to you the processes involved in concept making, concept learning, and I have also explained to you the processes involved in inquiry process. In each subject, you can begin like this. You have to use concept learning with inquiry in an inquiry mode. And then the third is problem solving. These are all of the same family. Problem solving method, inquiry method, concept learning, they are of the same family. एक ही परिवार के हैं. And ये तीनों क्या करेंगे? Higher level learning they will produce. Higher level learning, learning to analyze, learning to synthesize, learning to critically apply, use the criteria that you have developed or that will be required to be developed in a specific situation to arrive at decisions. So problem-solving learning is the highest type of learning. Again, there are five steps or five stages of problem-solving learning. The first stage is called identifying the problem. Identifying the problem. Just as when you do research, the first step is to identify a problem on which you can proceed and you can focus in order to find out the truth. So identifying the problem. The second stage is defining and delimiting the scope of the problem. Identifying the problem, then in problem-solving approach, you will help students to identify the problem. So it will be all teacher-guided. Then again, second step, teacher-guided. Help the students to define and delimit the scope of the problem. You will help the students to define and delimit the problem. For instance, if the problem is, when does it rain? Now your discussion will become why, how rain takes place. When does it rain? See, specific problem. Now we will say, in such and such temperature, what is the possibility of rain? So you will locate. And now we will say, it is the case of Dharamshala, or it is the case of Shimla, or it is the case of Varanasi. Varanasi clouds are very deceptive. But Shimla clouds are not very deceptive. If you find clouds, then it is sure to rain. But in Varanasi, or if you go to Chandigarh, those clouds. And so, raining clouds, the characteristics of clouds, how thick they should be, how dark they should be, you go on defining and delimiting the scope of the problem. And then, your third step will be developing, formulating a tentative solution of the problem. That is called hypothesizing. You'll say, in such and such situations, in such and such situation, it will rain. With such and such temperature, it will rain. With such and such temperature, it will not rain. So, अभी ये कह रहे थे आवाज हो रही थी तो प्रॉब्लम हमने जानबूझ के क्रिएट किया था मोबाइल होते हुए आवाज पहुंच गई थी अब हमने आपके कुछ हुआ लेकिन एक दूसरा मोबाइल भी मेरे पास है कहां तक पकड़ोगे आप मुझे मैं तो प्रॉब्लम क्रिएट कर रहा हूं देखो प्रॉब्लम सॉल्विंग अप्रोच में यू हैव टू लर्न टू रेज द प्रॉब्लम क्रिएट द प्रॉब्लम एंड unless you have been successful in creating the problem, जैसे मैंने successfully कर दिया कि बहुत से लोगों को सुनाई नहीं पड़ रहा था, अब ये आदमी आके बीच में इंटरवीन किया कि मोबाइल जो है थोड़ा ऐसा कर दीजिए, ये मामूली आदमी थोड़े है ये, मैं देख रहा था कितने लोगों को सुनाई पड़ रहा नहीं, अब मैं देख रहा था नहीं देख रहा था ये भी देखने वाली बात So, hypothesizing. And then fourth step is very important step, collection of evidence, data, information, facts, in favor of the hypothesis. Whatever hypothesis you have formulated, now you have to find out whether this hypothesis is acceptable or not. How will you decide that? By collecting evidence, data, information, relevant data, information. This is a very important stage. Collection of data, evidence. And last step is arriving at conclusions, generalizations. So you can do this in a group, or you can do this individually in your class. You pose the problem, ask the students to discuss about the problem, then help them to define and delimit the problem, then ask them, help them to advance a hypothesis, and then ask them on their own or with your help to find out the evidences which support the hypothesis and the evidences which do not support the hypothesis. And then after that, you do the analysis and arrive at conclusions in general. That is the problem-solving approach. One third of your syllabus in any subject may be assigned to problem-solving transactions, because our students have to be prepared through the subjects that we teach to undertake high-level learning, develop competencies, skills, which characterize high-level learning. So these three modes, concept learning, the second one, inquiry learning, and the third is problem solving. These three put together, they make what we call indirect methods. It's very challenging, and you'll find most of them go to the approach which we call constructivist approach in education. You have the cognitive approach, you have the behaviorist approach. Now here, the advanced form of cognitive approach is constructivist approach. Knowledge is to be acquired, constructed. Knowledge is not there. Knowledge is something personal. That is the constructivist approach. And with all these approaches, methods, you develop that view of learning, that view of knowledge. Knowledge means how I acquire it, what I acquire. So, I'm sure now you have got the difference between direct and indirect teaching methods. Lots of researches have been done. I have abstained from quoting researches, because if I quote those researches, aap mein se kuch log jo hain asahaj ho jayenge, samanya nahi rahenge, kahenge acha itna research ho raha hai, main to kuch bhi nahi kar raha hu. To ho sakta hai ye to nahi hoga. Yadi maan lo plethora of researches hum yahan la ke la dein, तो एक दो बार मैंने ऐसी गलती की भी है, ऑडियंस में से दो चार मूर्छित हो जाते कि क्या है ये, तो बड़ा मुश्किल है समझना. मैंने इसलिए बिल्कुल सिंपलीफाई करके आपको समझाया. कोई मूर्छित होने के कगार पर तो नहीं है? मूर्छित होना माने ओ गए, दैट इज मूर्छित. मूर्छित का मतलब एक्चुअली वो नहीं मूर्छित होना जो है, अलंकारिक भाषा में बोल रहा. So, I have simplified the presentation of direct teaching methods and the indirect teaching. It is for you to learn to use them in your situations. Now, there is a signal for tea break. After tea break, and I request you not to take more than 5 to 7 minutes.